In this tutorial, you will learn how to create this interesting 3D halftone motion graphics effect with Geometrynodes in Blender. You need at least Blender version 3.0 with the Geometrynodes fields for this to work. Hopefully, this workflow works for all the versions that come after 3.0. Or even better, Geometrynodes gets native Metaball support. But since this workaround exists, this might take a while. This tutorial is not exactly beginner friendly. You should know how to use basic Blender functionality, how to use Node Wrangler, and how to use Blender keyboard shortcuts. Intermediate to advanced users should have no problem following along and learn more about this great tool called Blender. This video is basically two tutorials in one. One, or part one, where we use Geometrynodes to make an interesting abstract artwork with twisted geometry that is the source that drives the metaballs in the second part and is nice to look at on its own. And then there is the second part where we turn the abstract artwork into a stylized halftone shaded artwork and then take it a level higher and make it a 3D halftone shaded artwork with Geometrynodes and metaballs. I recommend watching this tutorial completely to get better results. But if you only want to know how to use metaballs in Geometrynodes, you can of course use the chapters in this video and jump to part 2. It starts at around 7 minutes and 8 seconds. Oh, and by the way, my name is Chris. I record this for ToxicTuber. And I really need to thank the Blender users Salami and Art of Rias for helping me figure out how to use metaballs in Geometrynodes with instancing. So, let's get started with the tutorial and start by making the abstract twisted base animation. Change the render engine to Eevee. Then get ready to do some shading. I open a new panel to work on the world shader. The halftone shader works best with a high contrast, so we need two background shaders combined with a mix shader. The top one should be black, or the bottom one white. Use the input light path is camera ray value as mix factor. This tints the whole world black for nice shadows while painting a white background into the camera. The hotkeys Alt-R and Alt-G reset the camera rotation and position. This works on every mesh and object in Blender, and Alt-S resets the scaling. Now we can position the camera directly above the world origin. Setting a square render size makes it easier to work with the resulting artwork as a texture later in Geometrynodes. For the shading, plug a default white principled BSDF into a shader to RGB node and pipe that through a color ramp into an emission shader. Please note, the shader to RGB node only works within the Eevee render engine. Set the settings of the color ramp roughly to the values you see in the video. You can fine-tune these settings once we have a lamp in the scene. Well, okay, let's do this now. Add a sun lamp and rotate it until the object is well lit. Copy my settings for a light coming from the top right. Blender provides a good Geometrynodes preset as a workspace. Switch to that now. We need a torus to twist, so add a curve circle. This is the base. To give it some geometry, use the curve to mesh node and plug another curve circle into the profile to give it some volume. Double the resolution of the base circle, and to see the twist, use a low value for the resolution of the profile circle. To twist the torus in itself, add a set curve tilt node and plug a curve tilt node into the tilt factor. To manipulate that factor, we need a utilities math node. Keeping the math node on add and playing around with the slider already tilts the torus in itself. The curve parameter node gives values from 0 to 1 from the beginning of the curve to the end of the curve. Multiplying on this value lets us twist the torus in itself along its whole length. Multiplication with pi leads to half a rotation in itself and thus to ugly artifacts in the shading. You can write out pi directly into the math node and Blender knows how to handle this. Multiplication with 2 times pi leads to a full rotation and thus no artifacts. 2 times pi can also be written as tau directly into the math node. So only multiples of tau can be used here and lead to no shading artifacts. If you want your torus to make half a rotation only, for whatever reasons, there's a workaround by using a spiral curve, as this is an open curve and doesn't have to connect the beginning and the end in a perfect way. Play around with it, you can also use quarter rotations and add a set material node to give the generated geometry the material we created earlier. To animate all this, we need yet another math node, set to add right after the other math node. We could animate this with a driver, but if you want your animation to loop, you need to keyframe it from 0 to 1, from frame 1 to the last frame plus 1 of your animation length. Make sure that the keyframe interpolation is linear. In the dope sheet editor, press T over the keyframes and set it to linear. Now it's time to fine-tune the animation and the mesh. I changed the thickness of the torus and added a bevel. For the bevel, I used my bevLR plugin, which I will link in the description. The bevLR add-on adds a bevel to your mesh with one click and takes care of all the shading. With one click, it sets the bevel modifier shading to harden normals, and in the object data properties, it sets the normals to auto smooth. It also sets normal meshes to shade smooth, but in Geometrynodes you have to set this setting with a node. The last tweaks on the twisted geometry before rendering should include upping the resolution of the base circle, going to the render settings, and in color management change the view transform from filmic to standard for a really bright white color. This is not shown in the video, but just do it. And a tiny thing that bothered me can be turned off by going to the sunlight settings and turning off the shadows. This makes a better gradient in my opinion. Center the camera on the mesh object and render the animation. Welcome, welcome to the second part of this tutorial, where we use a black and white image texture to drive the values of the instances in Geometrynodes and then later use Metaballs within Geometrynodes. So, start a new Blender project, jump straight into the Geometrynodes workspace preset and add a Geometrynodes modifier to your favorite default mesh. We need something to instance our points on. A subdivided plane in Geometrynodes is achieved with a mesh primitive grid. Add a value node to both inputs for both X and Y, so we have a square ratio of vertices. 64 seems a good value for that while working on it. If your computer gets too slow, you can also try 32 or less. Plug the grid into the Geometrynodes output and we can see it already in the viewport. Plugging the grid into a mesh to points node turns every generated vertex into a point on which we can instance objects. To do so, we need an instance on points node, and as a placeholder we instance a mesh primitive cube on the points while working on the animation. Setting the scale value on the instance on points node to a really tiny amount makes it possible to see the individual instances instead of a huge blob of instances. Again, Alt-R and Alt-G resets the transformation and rotation of every mesh, in this case the camera. Let's place it so we have all our instances in view. A square render size puts the square grid in frame. Oh, while recording this, I added a scale instances node. But as long as the local space checkbox is checked on the scale instances node, changing the scale on that node is the same as changing the scale on the instance on points node. So just roll with it. Since we want to influence the scale of our instances with an image texture we created earlier, we add an image texture node, set it to the image sequence we created earlier, plug that into a color ramp, and from there into a vector math node set to multiply. The bottom of that multiply vector node now controls the size of all the instances relative to the black and white values in the image texture. Since we watch it from top down, the set value can stay zero and give no height to the instances. To keep a square ratio on the instances, we plug one single value into the X and Y of a combined XYZ node, and that goes into the bottom socket of the multiply node. Enter a small value into the value node. Let's set up the image texture now. plug an input position node into the vector input of the image texture and set the frame of the image sequence to 1 to see what you are doing. A multiply add a vector math node works similar to the mapping node in shader nodes. The multiplication vector is for scaling. The add or addend vector of the multiplication add node is for the position. Set it to 0.5 on the first two values, as these correspond to the X and Y mapping of the 2D image sequence. To playback the image sequence, plug a value node into the frame socket of the image texture and use a driver with the current frame number to be the frame number of the image sequence. To add the driver, simply put the cursor into the input field of the value node and type hashtag frame. To test this, I open a timeline, and while we are there, I set the frame count of the animation to a reasonable value. The source animation has 96 frames, so let's set it to 96. And test the animation by pressing the play button on the timeline or just hitting the spacebar. Well, this looks like an interesting halftone effect already, don't you think? You could, in theory, replace the cube with every other mesh you want, as simple or complex as you like. But we want to make it even better by using Metaballs instead. But using said Metaballs is not as easy as just using an object info node with a Metaball selected, but it can be done with a little trick. Just follow along. To limit the amount of calculations Geometrynodes has to do, we need to limit the selection. Ctrl-Shift-D duplicates the selected node, including all the noodles plugged into it. Alt-Shift and left-click on a node lets you preview the geometry of that node in Geometrynodes, similar to Ctrl-Shift and left-click in the shader nodes with Node Wrangler. Preview the mesh-to-points node like this to see all points it generates, then plug the color ramp into the selection socket. Set the interpolation of the color ramp to constant to have a harsh falloff, and then move the black slider along until all the points disappear where we don't want any to appear. The first method to use Metaballs with Geometrynodes that is probably a bit easier on your computer is filled with instances of instances of instances of instances of instances. Basically, we want to instance one single vertex on each vertex of the bigger grid of vertices to be able to instance a Metaball on the instance of a vertex instanced on a vertex of a lot of vertices instances. One way to create that vertex is with a mesh line and a count set to 1. And a very important step is to set a realize instances node as last node before the output node. Finally, we can add the Metaball to the 3D viewport as a new object and scale it down to a really, really small size, something like 0.007 fits. Now it is important to parent the Metaball to the mesh that has the Geometrynodes modifier. Then go to the object properties, open the instancing option and click vertices. Voila! A first step to success. This method is easy on what it demands from your PC, but you will soon notice there is no way to control the size of the Metaballs individually with the texture or anything else. So we can file this method as computer friendly, but to do the real magic we need to do it a little bit different. Just follow along. We replace the mesh line with yet another grid and set the vertex count on both the X and the Y to 2. In the object properties, set the instancing to faces and activate the scale by face size option. It is able to show the instancer both in viewport and render, and we are almost done. Fine-tune the relative scaling value and the color ramp to your liking, and we have a cool halftone animation made from Metaballs running already. To take that halftone artwork to another dimension, we need to displace it on the z-axis. To do that, add a geometry set position node right after our base grid that spawns all the vertices. We instance all the other levels of instances on. Now we build a little displacement vector by plugging three different random value nodes into a combined XYZ or Z node. Set really small values for the X and the Y. Make them go from negative to positive to displace in both directions and play around with the values and take my values as a rough guide. For the Z value, I figured it would be better to displace it only in one direction, with also a very small value. And this nice random value vector goes into the offset socket of the Z position node. Tweak these random settings to your likings. One value I absolutely had to change was the size of that one metaball that gets instanced a lot. Now let's take a quick look at the shading of our artwork. The metaball and all its instances is a simple BSDF with a black color and a very low value for the roughness. That's all there is to this shader. The Worldshader also is nothing overly complicated. Actually, it's just a plain color. You could use an HDRI to light the scene, but for a stylized artwork like this, I prefer a plain color, or maybe a gradient. To make the whole thing look a bit more interesting, I added a backlight by simply adding a plane with an emission shader on it. You can play with that color according to your world lighting and hopefully find a good looking and fitting color combination. In the compositing stage, I added a glare node with a very high threshold because of the very bright backlight, but I used a negative mix factor to not overdo it with the glare. Also, I added a very, very subtle lens distortion effect. It's hardly noticeable, but it's there. Now that you know all this, play around with this liquid halftone effect made with Metaballs and Geometrynodes in Blender. Send me your variations on Twitter or Instagram, or as a comment here on YouTube, and have fun with it and make some great artworks. And let this be a very creative 2022. See you on the other side.